literature, second life, and I'm here an attempt to combine the two in some way to talk about how to live, what to do. And I'm going to take it as a given and not take up very much time talking about the climate change situation. And if you saw the geoengineering panel that we did yesterday, you'll see that there are recent photographs that just establishes that we are headed for climate change that will be better or worse. And the question is, what can we do to make it better for us and for our descendants? And one of the things that's interesting about this notion of climate change and utopia is it an oxymoron? Could we, as a thought experiment, imagine both happening? Since climate change is, at this point, to a greater or lesser extent, inevitable, then utopia is not at all inevitable, of course, but needs to be considered as happening in the context of a fairly rapid climate change on the planet, which of course makes it more difficult, because in the changing physical parameters and the stress that the cultures on this planet would be put under, and all of the biosphere and all the rest of the species, it only makes that much more difficult, you might say, to come to a just and sustainable interpretation of permaculture as a problem, which I think it is a word with an Australian provenance, permaculture. And I like this word because it suggests both permanence and permutation, constant, a dynamic state rather than a static state. So particularly since sustainable development is somewhat of a captured phrase, which now means let us continue to do what we were doing before and get away with it. You need a different phrase than sustainable development, and permaculture is a really good one. So I would suggest that. And I also would like to say that although you can run thought experiments in which you run full-scale climate change and then ask yourself whether utopia is possible in that framework so that you have science fiction novels you ought to have that are a kind of a jungle planet or an ice-free planet, and then also utopian human situation, interesting thought experiment, but in physical terms, difficult to justify. You really there go into a kind of a J.G. Ballard dream space, like the drowned world, in which it's quite clear that Ballard personally likes the disasters that he invokes and is really happy in the drowned London, because it's an escape to freedom, it's an escape from the reality that he found oppressive, etc. So, I don't think that if we allow climate change to go on unchecked, in other words, that we could then at the same time postulate a better society. I don't think it's biophysically possible. For one thing, if the acidity of the oceans is allowed to rise with the CO2 rise, about 40% of the CO2 we put in the atmosphere ends up in the oceans. And we've already measured an increased acidity on the pH scale, which is amazing when you consider how big the ocean is and how much of a carbon sink it represents. And yet we've measured the difference. And although nobody can be sure, if the acidity of the ocean gets much higher, the littlest creatures that have carbonate shells may have their shells eaten away and go extinct. And it's a food pyramid like any other food pyramid, that if the bottom of the food chain is gone, the top of the food chain and everything in between is also gone. And about one third of humanity's food comes out of the oceans. So, if we keep on putting C2 in the atmosphere, we may be killing our own food in the most direct way and quantifiable way. So, now, the idea of utopia, of a sustainable and just civilization, the two being tied together, has gone from a good idea to a survival necessity. And this is kind of interesting, because when I began as a science fiction writer, utopia was seen as the kind of nice idea that good people had, but it wasn't the way the world worked, etc., etc., etc. So a pretty idea, but very impractical and theoretical and kind of a wish rather than a plan. And now, 35 years later, utopia has become a survival requirement instead. So this is a big change.
And it's also true, and it's paradoxical, I mean, on the other hand, when I was young, to write in Utopia, you had to write about a perfect and well-ordered society. Now all you have to do is write about human survival and you're called a utopian writer. So the standards have dropped since I began. One of the things that's interesting to think about immediately is, are we in fantasy land now talking about how it might be made right? And I use this image, I've used it before, of the of Wile E. Coyote from the great Chuck Jones cartoons. You know, Wile E. Coyote's chasing Roadrunner, trying to kill Roadrunner. He runs off the cliff, and he's there. He's unaware that he's no longer on the ground, and he's spinning along in the air. He looks at the audience. He looks down, and he says, oh, shit. And soon he drops down into the desert floor, thousands of feet below. How many times has that happened? And what I'm using this image for is, are we in the Wile E. Coyote moment? Are we in space? Are we spinning and thinking that we're still on the ground? And we haven't yet looked around and noticed that we're actually in free fall. In other words, with the best will in the world, can we get out of the path dependency towards disaster that we are already in? And it's a good first question, I think. And what I would point you to in terms of Googling words afterwards to follow up ideas that I'm throwing out here is simply wedge diagrams. They come out of Princeton University, and I bet his name is Sokolov, I think. Yeah, and these wedge diagrams show that it is still possible to get ourselves rapidly to a decarbonized, a carbon neutral, and sometimes even carbon negative state from where we are now. So we're still talking science fiction rather than fantasy, which I find comforting. And the wedge diagrams are suggested because although they show that we can make our way from the state we're in now in the world to sustainability and permaculture, it really would require action on every single front. The wedges are the shapes of carbon burn reduced from thick to thin, but all the way across the board in every single possible plan that has been put forth needs to be put forth and enacted simultaneously and across the board, including things that many of my fellow environmentalists are quite nervous about, such as a bridge technology of one more or two more generations of nuclear power, which is, although it has many very serious problems, is at least not putting carbon into the atmosphere at the same rate as burning fossil fuels. There is carbon burn associated with nuclear power. It's not free, but it is so much less, and we are in such a carbon emergency that I think it's worth considering that, and indeed, the wedge diagrams usually include a generation of nuclear power as a green strategy. And so, for people who don't like to, for people who like purity, which is really a bad thing to like, this is disturbing. But if you accept that it's the carbon problem that's central and serious, then nuclear power has to be accepted with all the reservations and fears and problems involved with it as a bridge technology to something much cleaner, more sophisticated, and better. Granting these assertions on my part as being true, then one of the problems is going to be the immense political resistance to enacting this program of reducing carbon. And of course, a lot of the resistance is going to come from the carbon industry. It already has. And a scholar at University of California, San Diego, my alma mater, and now she is provost of the sixth college there, Naomi Oreskes, has documented in incontrovertible, like legally solid evidential detail, the campaign by the fossil fuels industry to obfuscate and confuse people on this issue, which they have learned from the tobacco industry. And even there's even some of the same of these scientists for hire that did this kind of work for the tobacco industry that are now doing it for the fossil fuels industry for pay. And Oreskes has showed that, and this is something I said before this weekend, that in this case the fossil fuels industry has acted more scientifically than the scientists themselves. because they did experiments, they did research, what confuses the public? How do they get confused? So they paid money for experiments where they went to American towns and they took polls to get people's opinions before and after they would run newspaper campaigns and other kinds of public relation campaigns to see with what most effectively confuses people. And having done those experiments and gotten the results, they then enacted the results and have confused the public in the United States, which is the only area that I know well on this issue, and I think is the focus of Oreskes' book. But I take it that it's a global campaign. So not only do we have to do this in ways that are technically and logistically difficult, it's simply a problem of scale to change one's entire civilization's infrastructure. So let's say it's different than the problem with ozone layer. It turned out that refrigerator coolants needed to be changed or else we were going to kill ourselves. Hilarious but true. And so we did it because refrigerator coolant was a small enough industrial chemical to be able to make a complete switch in and solve the problem of burning up our ozone layer. This done by a sort of science fictional inspection of the atmosphere of Venus. So really, the planetary scientists have been already justified in their work. Like, let's go study the other planets, and people in New Zealand, they call this blue sky research. You know, in other words, irrelevant and crazy research. But on the other hand, it's saved us all from being cooked like bugs. And is one of the first examples that you want to give when you're talking about the usefulness of planetary research to human direct human concerns. So, okay, it's going to be hard because there's going to be active human resistance to the campaign to do this. And therefore, there's going to need to be an active political campaign to overwhelm this resistance. And, you know, the best defense is good offense, and you're simply going to have to steamroll eventually the fossil fuels industry in the same way that eventually the tobacco industry has been overwhelmed in their assertions that tobacco does not kill people. Now, we say that it does, and we'll make it illegal for kids, and we go on and within a certain freedom of action, like if you're an adult and you're stupid enough to want to do this, you can. But in general, it is now widely understood that tobacco kills. And when it's understood widely enough that cancer, that carbon kills in the way that we're using it, then there will be changes in public behavior, in private behavior, and the job will be accomplished despite the resistance of the unpaid employees of the fossil fuel industry. And I think it's worth telling this story because I'm assuming everybody already knows it, but it's not true. Everybody doesn't yet know it. They don't know the evidence is there. They don't know how conscious the campaign to confuse people on global and climate change has been. And the more that you know it, the more you spread the word, the more cultural change happens by word of mouth, ultimately. By people talking in their families, amongst the friends that you trust enough to have a political argument with, which is a pretty high level of trust, and on it goes like that. And there can be rapid cultural change. The cultural attitudes between, say, 1928 and 1932, extremely rapid change into a completely different cultural mindset. The same is true between, say, 1978 and 1982, at least in the United States, and I lived through that cultural change myself, and I can tell you it's confusing and a little bit dizzying to see how rapidly the entire culture can change its fundamental basis of operation, of understanding, I should say. So now let me come to another, I think, super interesting question about this, which is, will we have to give up our privileges as first world people? Here's the thing. A lot of people will roughly do math in their head. They'll say there's 7 billion of us, and about a third are doing really quite well. About a third are scrabbling along best they can, and about a third are in misery, and living on $2 a day or less, and struggling day to day to keep enough food, shelter, clothing, water. And so when those of us are in the top third, and effectively for this audience, including myself, we could say really the top 10th or in certain ways the top 50th of the world population, And then the notion is, well, we need to share equally on this planet because, well, first of all, it's the just thing to do, the fair thing to do, but of course that's never had any influence on anybody. But now it's the survival thing to do. In the top part of the world population and the bottom part of the world population are the two worst environmental impacts. The top through hyperconsumption and overconsumption of resources. The bottom through environmental degradation of deforestation and topsoil loss. Because if you're desperate, you will cut down a tree, you will eat your seed corn, you will overwork your fields in order to get that next day, and next season's meals. So these are the two big environmental impact population groups, and they both need to go away. And so being in the top group, one has to worry. It's inevitable. And it's not just selfishness, it's also thinking about your kids, about a decent life, etc. And God, if all 7 billion on the planet had to share equally the carbon burn of the civilization, then maybe I have to live like a saint, maybe I have to suffer, maybe I don't get to have the same life I had before. And that's almost like reincarnation. I mean, we are so much interpenetrated by our socialized, by our societies, that if society changes utterly, you also change utterly, and nobody wants it, because there's a certain desire for continuity of self over time. And so it's frightening. So the Swiss, being Swiss, practical people, have done this calculation. And it's a 2,000 watts per year per person. And I have to say immediately, I don't know what that means in linear terms exactly, but it's also been translated into 17,500 kilowatt hours per year. And I know my electrical bill tells me that my photovoltaic system on the roof creates about 6,000 kilowatt hours per year. And so I have a way to judge what that means. And the Swiss come to the same conclusion that I did after trying to comprehend these numbers as an English major. And I'm sorry I can't do a better, somebody needs to do a better lecture that actually physicalizes what that means in real life terms. But Wikipedia already has an excellent article on this, and it begins to bring it more alive to everyone what it means. But I can give you the short form. It means that it's not that bad. There are prosperous Swiss in Basel and Zurich who are living that life already as an experiment to see what it would feel like. And they have some unnatural advantages of 500 years of European colonialism ripping off the rest of the world and taking it back to Europe and building a really fine infrastructure so that you can live in Switzerland without a car, without any problem, and have a wonderful travel life, etc., etc. This is true across most of Europe. So the averages right now, the ordinary European citizen is burning about 6,000 watts a year. The ordinary Swiss citizen, 5,000. The ordinary American citizen, 12,000. Sorry, you know, that's us. That's America for you. The ordinary Chinese citizen, on the average, 1,500 watts a year. In India, 1,000. And in Bangladesh, 300. So this is the spread, in case you're thinking about it. And what would be interesting to contemplate immediately in your own life, in the same way that you can get on your master group scale and weigh yourself, you can get on the carbon burn scale and weigh yourself. It's not hard. You've got your odometer for your car. If you've got a car, you've got your bills. You can calculate it pretty damn quickly and easily. Look at what you've got and see whether you can bring it down to the world average and still live the life you want to live. And then it becomes kind of a project, something to enact. Feel a little bit clever, good at tech. So you're doing clean tech, you're doing appropriate technology, you're doing sophisticated living on this planet, and living an extremely well-fed, well-housed, well-educated, and in essence, a full human life, and yet not doing the American thing of burning six times as much energy as you need to do that. And in fact, the standard average calculation right now is that U.S. citizens use up 32 times as many resources as the developing world peasants do. So 30 times more resources and yet not even twice as much happiness, because with that hyper-consumption comes craziness. You know, the neuroticism of hyper-consumption that leads to a kind of moral obesity, so that instead of being happier, they're actually crazy. So it isn't even effective. If you say, well, you know, this kind of complacency, well, you burn 32 times as much as you do, but we're Donald Trump, you know, we're fantastically happy compared to you. But it's a lie. It's actually unhealthy. And since health and happiness are almost synonyms, that what you're seeing is a hyperconsumption as part of a commodity machine. There is an economic engine that is profiting from it. And so both in our production and in our consumption, we're simply rats on a wheel being manipulated by somebody else. We run on a wheel, and there's nothing abnormal about it. In fact, it's a little bit stupid. So without wanting to go into too much detail about it, I just want to tell you the story of my standard lecture to American college audiences that I've been doing now for 5 years and can't stand to do anymore, although it's useful, it's just tiresome. But what I would do would go to a college crowd and explain the situation to them and say, consider what you are. Let's think about what science tells us we are. We're primates. We are, as a species, a couple hundred thousand years old. We are 90% genetically the same as the chimpanzees and the other primates in the ape family. We're no different from them in so many ways that you can hardly believe it. But even just as a species of around Homo sapiens, a primate of a little fur but great cleverness, we evolved to do certain things. And the brain expanded from about one-third of its current size to its current size in about a million years or less, which in evolutionary terms is just spectacular growth. Grown so fast and so big that it can't grow any bigger or else the kid can't get through the birth canal. As many moms can tell you, it's already a close thing. And so this evolutionary growth happened of the brain, and of course the body that goes along with it, the uprightness, the handedness, the ability to run all day at a very slow pace, but nevertheless, great endurance, a pretty impressive primate as a group, something like wolves, dangerous in packs, not that dangerous in isolation. So here we are, pack animals with certain abilities that we've evolved to in these last half million years, and we have not changed even one gene from that point that we were at, say, 50,000 years ago or 20,000 years ago, and yet our lifestyle has completely changed utterly. So what's interesting to me, the period of evolutionary growth of the brain was actually a super stable lifestyle. We can tell this from the archaeological record, that the Acheulean hand axe was a tool that we don't even quite know what this tool was for. It may have been a kind of Swiss Army knife. They did a lot of different things. There's simply hundreds of thousands of them scattered around the old world. And they stayed the same for almost 300,000 years without a change in the tool. And this is a sign that the culture itself was super stable. And maybe there were things changing that we cannot find now, like the growth of language. I mean, speculation as to the rapid growth of the brain, because it is kind of a paradox. You know, we were living the same every day, and yet the brain was growing like a balloon. Well, I say accept the paradox and look very closely at how we were living that was associated and was so much involved with our growth as human beings. And what you see is a very simple list of very simple activities. Walking, talking, looking at fire, cooking, obviously eating, obviously sex, but also dancing, music, being outdoors most of every day, sleeping on the ground, etc., etc. I've made the Paleolithic list, and it doesn't take very long, and seeing things by moonlight, for instance, being able to make a bed on the ground without much forethought, in the same way that you might be surprised that you're good at sex the first time you do it, like somebody else knows about this, and thank God for that. Well, you can make yourself a bed on the ground without anyone training you how to, surprising and yet true. And it goes on like that. So I'll put the Paleolithic list even up on a PowerPoint, which is like the only time in my life I've ever tried to use visual aids, just to help people to think about it. We still do all these activities.
And yet almost every one of them has been commodified and technologized and turned into something that other people can make money off of. And for you doing them when they've been altered like this, they're either augmented, so that, say, you're running, but you're actually, you're sitting on your butt and you're going like 70 miles an hour because you're in a car. Well, that's not technological sublime, because if in your paleolithic mind, it's a kind of a miracle. Even more so to the point of terror, going to fly an airplane, look out the window, etc. Every one of the activities on the list, including, you know, sex as pornography, has either been augmented by technology or else virtualized by technology. So they don't really do it. You watch it being done, or you do it with your thumbs and watch the images of it being done, rather than doing it with your body. And sometimes this creates a technological sublime. You go into this state of ecstasy that we live in so much that we get used to it as normality itself, and actually take paid vacations in order to get out of the technological sublime and just sit on the beach for a week and de-technologize ourselves, once again paying for it. Suppose, you know, just to get back to the paleolithic norm, and which is experienced as a relief and a vacation and a wonderful thing. Even though, at any point in your life, you can simply walk outdoors, sit down on the ground, in the sunlight, talk to a friend, face to face, in actual physical contact, often good to do a little grooming, to be in physical contact, touching each other, talking. Well, it turns out that's almost the best event of every day. And all of the stuff that's being paid for is part of this hyper-consumption stupidity. And the kids who've fallen in love with various sports, almost every sport is just like throwing rocks at fans. That's what it comes down to. And what a joy. Just to throw a rock, and then if you hit something, it's like, oh my God. So thus the kids that'll shoot baskets all evening for now. And you know, making 10 baskets in a row is more important to them than getting an A in the class. In other words, their life priorities seem completely skewed, and yet not, because what's really happening is they're getting back into their paleolithic mind, which is so huge, so powerful. So when I give this lecture to college kids, about somewhere between a tenth to a quarter of the audience has got the big light bulb gone off over their head. It's a beautiful thing to see. It's just quite visible on their faces that they've been thinking this all their life, but inchoately, incoherently, and without anybody ever telling it to them from a lecture stage, and without anybody ever theorizing of giving them the reasons why they feel the way they do, the power of their emotions. So it keeps me traveling. It keeps me talking to college audiences, just to see that look on people's faces. And if it has a use value, all the better, because it turns out that all these paleolithic activities are extremely low carbon. They just are. If you run the carbon burn, the technological sublime is almost high carbon burn, and the paleolithic norm is always as low carbon burn as you can get. It still burns carbon, because we eat, we breathe, etc. We're animals. There's no doubt about it. You cannot get to carbon negative without some kind of extreme technological method. An ordinary paleolithic life does burn carbon, but so much less than what we do as technological humans, that you can do what makes you healthier, what makes you happier as an animal, and also makes you more virtuous as a world citizen in the year 2010. So college kids are thinking, these goddamn baby boomers, they torch the planet, and now we have to behave like saints to make up for it. Nobody likes that, to hear that message. It's a much better message to take to a young audience and say, you know what, this is a stupid world, and there's a lot of suggestions out of the culture asking you to pay with your life for doing stupid stuff and making yourself unhealthy and unhappy. You can always walk away. This is something that Dalai Lama says. You can always walk away from injustice. And you can always walk away from stupidity, too. And this is something that when college students hear it, they're thinking, well, I've got stupid debts, and now I've got to get a stupid job and I'm going to pay my stupid debts, etc. They're already on the wheel, but nevertheless, they're a lot less on the wheel than those of us with mortgages, with children, with job obligations, and with this idea in our heads that all that crap matters, and in terms of keeping the kids alive, it does matter. So in a way, it's better to talk to the young and get them
track down a different track. Because path dependency, a phrase out of engineering and out of ecology, in other words, whatever path you're on, you depend on it, and you cannot change it instantaneously. There's a certain path dependency to the built infrastructure, and even to our culture itself. So, and then, you know, especially since yesterday, I went through the indulgence of telling you all about my personal life and what I love. I will just continue with that because it fits so well with the Paleolithic life. And this is not Paleolithic, it's Neolithic. Just keeping a garden. And even if you don't have land that you can turn into a garden, because some people don't, you do have usually enough room and sunlight to put some plants in pots and start to grow a little bit of food. And this is transformative. Not because you grow very much of your total food. I keep a pretty big garden, and in my part of the world, I can grow two or three crops a year on that land. In other words, a good winter crop as well as a summer crop, so they're really different crops. And yet I still think, I've tried to estimate, I think I grow about maybe 2 to 5% of my family's food, maybe 10% in midsummer, with a Greek salad every day coming out of the land for lunch. But 10% would probably represent the highest point and most optimistic. So it's not true quantity here, it's quality and also education. What it does for you psychologically to know that you're growing food, to pay attention to it, and to realize how out of control you are, how immediately you understand those agricultural cultures that have like a god for everything. Well, of course, it makes perfect sense. You instantly start praying to the weather god and to the soil god and to the fungus god. Please do not put a cucumber fungus in my garden this morning because I like my green salads, etc. And it's not under your control. You cannot go down to the local market and get a Home Depot or whatever, get a pesticide that will take care of many of these problems. You know, this whole engineering notion that problem solution doesn't work that way, and particularly if you're in an organic garden, and the agreement is that nobody will use artificial poisons to kill things off, then it becomes harder. And even if you had the full panoply of pesticides, you could not guarantee that things would go well. Little droughts, little disasters, little epidemics, and suddenly you are in banned land if you couldn't go down to the grocery store. And that'll make you religious in the bad way of fear. But it's educational, because our whole society is trapped in that situation. We only have about 6 months of food reserves for the population of the planet. It's only going to take the slightest little disaster in food supply to panic the world, and hoarding will begin, and hoarding kills the supply system. When demand goes into it, supply can't keep up with it, then everything crashes and social trust goes away. In essence, we are on a tightrope together. Big, skinny tightrope. It's not even individual that they can keep your balance. We all have to agree to keep balance as a group, like some ridiculous circus troupe. And then there's idiots jumping on one end of it, trying to move on. So it's worse than just everybody cooperating. It's like 70% of us cooperating and 30% of us trying to knock us off out of some perversion of the spirit and the intellect. They don't understand the situation apparently. Part of keeping a garden is keeping a compost heap. And then you kind of get into that whole circle of life thing and it gets pretty interesting. And you don't feel so wasteful with all the food that you throw away as a first world person. Because you're not really throwing it away, you're just creating very expensive soil. And you cannot keep mice and rats out of the compost heap, so now you've got pets, you know, they're wild pets. And they're bold. And every time you turn the compost, you suddenly feel the power of a god. You know, it's apocalypse now for an entire community that you're going to knock apart. And some of them resent it and bare their teeth at you as they run away. And they're going to be back. So hopefully, I actually knocked my compost heap to say, you know, this is the end of the world, get the babies out of the way and bring them back later. And you can see that happen over a period of time. And then be a bunch of mice and rats carrying these tiny little pink things away and looking at me like, and then come back and all is well. And then, you know, after you speared a few little pink babies with a pitchfork, you don't want to do that anymore, so that you try to coexist with your own fellow people, the horizontal brothers and sisters, as John Muir put it so beautifully, that we live with us on this planet and so often treat as mere objects, but the more you pay attention, the more you understand that especially the mammals on this planet are just people who happen to take slightly different shapes. And it's not at all clear that we are more intelligent than any other mammal on this planet. So there's a political aspect to this. You have to vote on this. You have to argue on this. You have to try to get first to your government to more green, to more social democrat, to more justice, to more women's rights. All that is crucially important. But what I think is better is a necessary complementary component to that is to live the life already in advance of the fact. They used to talk about already existing Marxism, already existing socialism, and it's important to pay attention to that and understand it, etc., etc. I would say we have already existing socialism, which is the project of science itself, the project of togetherness, but also already existing utopia in the way that you try to live within the giant capitalist world machine that we're in, to alter it from inside, from the grassroots level, from denying validity of their underlying assumptions of what is goodness, what is success. Saying, you know what, that's a con, that's a scam you're running on me to steal my life. And I have a different plan. And I have friends who do it too. I have a world community that does it too. Because now on the internet, everybody who has this view can be linked up and know that you aren't just a freak or an eccentric. You know, I love Henry David Thoreau, but his sense of isolation within his world of Walden, of Concord, Massachusetts in 1860 was severe because he felt like a crazy person for being sane. Well, we don't have to suffer through that. We have a perfectly good human contact with like-minded citizens, and we can try for that cultural change to where figure and ground reverse, to where what's seen as eccentric and is become centric in the literal sense of taking over the center from the outside in, from the periphery. And then if power is stupid, then maybe you can make it crash like some lonely dinosaur, and you'd be the little mammals calling around and knowing with the help of the prophecy and vision of science fiction, knowing that you're on the right side of history if we are going to survive at all. So this, I'm going to bring it to a close and open it up to questions with just the idea that this is a kind of a potted version of my current stump speech to the world, what I would say to the college kids, and what I share with the science fiction community with the full belief that it's already pretty much known to everybody, and it's just something that we kind of celebrate and go out there and work on. At least that's what I hope and trust. Okay, thanks. Let's shift over to questions. Yes, sir.
Those of us who grew up in the U.S., and particularly in California, a little earlier than you, had the Whole Earth Catalog, which was a very sustainable way of living and showed a lot of third world ways of living. So how do you overcome this cultural inertia that seems to be built in?
Well, this is a question about how there was a moment, the Whole Earth Catalog moment, the sort of 70s utopian moment. I've talked about this actually early last week at a different conference about how there is a utopian literature out of the 1970s, and the Whole Earth Catalog is just one of many books, where essentially the hippie generation, and actually I'm right there with you, when they grew up enough to start having kids, thought, how do we put our revolutionary ideals into action in the world? And there was progress as if survival mattered, and the integral urban house, and small is beautiful, and muddling towards frugality, and appropriate technology. These are all titles. I had a whole bookshelf of them. And my book, Pacific Edge, is an expression of that moment. But then the Reagan Thatcher revolution was a cultural revolution as well as a political revolution. Why it succeeded is beyond me to explain, but it did succeed. And we're still in an aftermath of that pendulum swing back to the right, back to privilege and power for a few, and back to the idea that we can just ignore the earth, and et cetera, et cetera. I mean, I don't want to go on against that. So how do we do it? I think by word of mouth, and also by the way you live, by what I've been talking about, and by our votes, by our political action. I mean, here in Australia, the Green Party just had its biggest victory ever. So, good for you. And also, the preferential voting system. Really wish we had that. The compulsory voting, preferential voting, there simply is a more intelligent system down there. And I say that without meaning to, I don't want to pander because there's all obvious Australian stupidities as well, and you all know those too, better than I do. And there's only 20 million of you, so in a way it's kind of a miniature experiment in good living because it's really a rather small population for such a gigantic continent. So, you know, but conserve is the lead, you know, the thought experiment. This is how things can be done right and still live a good life. It has immense value in the world. Yes?
Not to be negative, but obviously you've been traveling a lot. You flew through Australia.
Yeah.
How do you reconcile that with your call to the carbon?
Well, it blows my carbon budget back. And I tell you, you know, being a guest of honor at WorldCon, I would have gone to Jupiter for that. It's a lifetime career honor. But in fact, I turned down about 95% of the invitations I get to travel. I'll go to college campuses thinking maybe there will be a net positive by my convincing people. And then I do put it into the calculations and I swear when I get home, I'll never travel again. Because my carbon burden, if I didn't fly, would be nicely impressive. I can't do this lot calculation, but I will say that I am about one quarter of the American average. And it's not just me being virtuous, it's Davis, California being arranged for bicycles. So, in other words, society makes it possible. My own town makes it possible. My village homes, which is a little utopian common that gives me that regardless place, makes it possible. And then I get in a jet and, you know, carbon is burning and I'm adding to that. So I try to travel a little less every year, and I've actually, you know, can do calculations of mileages. It's actually part of the online calculation. If you're going to do a carbon burn calculation, your flying miles are included, and are usually dedicated to a good total. And so I can only just plead mea culpa, you know, and it's because of you guys. It's because of the greatness of the WorldCon Guest of Honor honor, which for me, and being a part of the science fiction community, is like being mayor for the day or whatever. You know, it's one of the most significant honors that I ever expect to get. And it will only come once, because that's the way things work in WorldCon land. So, it would have been better if it was next year when I'm in Reno, but Australian, because I live right next to Reno, but Australians are nicer to me than Americans. Yeah. Sci-fi back in the 70s, and then the great John Brenner novels, etc., and then now, and Avatar. And I like the messages about Avatar and Wall-E. I saw Wall-E in an audience of American tourists, and it was an extremely uncomfortable thing for all of us to see together because of the hypocrisy of the lifestyle of the people on the spaceship. Very interesting to hear the mutedness of the laughs and the applause at the end, because everybody felt the sting of that. So yes, eco-fiction will come back, and you know, to the extent that it does come back. There's a thing called topic saturation, and there's also a thing called denial, that you don't want to hear bad news that you know is perfectly true. And since the news is filled with this kind of stuff, you've got topic saturation. When fiction comes along and says, let me tell you a story about global warming, a lot of people think, I already know, and I don't want to hear anymore. And if it's me saying, but I'm going to make it a comedy, they're going to be saying, yes, but Stan, you're you're crazy, and we already know that, and so therefore we don't necessarily believe you because you're an interested party and an admitted maniac. So what we need is new people, and this is kind of neat because you have people like Paolo Bajica, who would be young, a science fiction writer, shot into the firmament immediately with his first novel, and his second novel, Shipbreaker, is very much eco fiction, and people haven't prejudged him, is what I'm saying. So we need lots of new voices that haven't already been stuck in their slot. Stan Robinson, our Boy Scout, our maniac. You know, I know what he's going to say. I therefore don't have to read anymore. So what I want to see is not me anymore. I just want to do space opera. You know? But what a whole generation of younger writers and readers doing this kind of stuff. That's really what I'd like to see. Oh, yes, up there, almost.
Yep. 1940 writers, Newton's book, right? By 1940, it's going to potentially help this really from me.
Well, I wonder about that. It would be nice, I think so. I only know the American situation, and I actually do know the Navajo Reservation north of Flagstaff, Arizona. I know the Navajo. Because my great aunt was converting them to Christianity. And I was part of that when I was a kid. And you know, the cool thing is that Navajo ignored all that and turned us all into Navajo, and so they reversed the process. But they have a separate nation within the United States that is incredibly poor, living off the land and off of sheep herding and pickup trucks with a whole lot of basketball. And so, but the poverty involved is shocking and is so extreme that I wonder how they can help us. We need to help them in that without being disrespectful or condescending. Simply, they need to be given as much of their resources as anybody else, including their own land, etc., etc. So they can serve as an example. Yeah, well, it would be nice if we could pay more attention and help there. It's the same in all the native communities I've ever heard of. Alcoholism is stupendously a hammer to the head of that culture. And so, yeah, it's complicated. But now, at this point, so many of them have died. You're really talking about, you know, 1% or less of the world's populations. And so what they can do is teach us an attitude towards the earth, but then again, they were always treating the earth as a part that needed to be manipulated for their own good. So it isn't as if, I don't know, I don't exactly know that. That's worth further discussion, because I don't know exactly what to say to that. Yeah.
When you use this video of famous reports of genetically engineered eucalyptus tree plantations, that have been a source of toxins in the water supply in Tasmania. They've been poisoning humans and wildlife. They've been poor health of the oysters, possibly the cause of the facial tumour disease that is ravaging the Tasmanian devil population. And they're in that area where they have the plantation, there is a very big percentage of rare cancer. Now, I was just wanting to ask, what is your view on genetic modification and the possible risks? And would it be better to move away from a monoculture society to using chemicals and genetic modification to a polyculture society promoting biodiversity in conjunction with organics?
Yeah, the question about genetically modified organisms and my opinion of them, thank you for that. It's another interesting and problematic issue because, like being a supporter with qualifications and with fear of another generation of nuclear power, I will state unequivocally that genetic engineering can be a good thing and part of our way out. It's dangerous, and that there are unexpected side effects. And my wife is an environmental toxicologist tracing the fate of pesticides in groundwater and surface water. And so I often have on my computer screen lists of 250 toxic chemicals that are sometimes combined in ways that make them even worse. So I'm aware of the dangers. But I also have a close friends, a couple of greatest, two professors, one of them a rice geneticist, who has helped to engineer the rice that can withstand 2 month floods in Bangladesh rather than 2 week floods. Just a simple tweak. And she also was involved with putting in vitamin A in some of the rice grains in China, I believe. And so she's a genetic engineer. And the Bangladeshi government has had her over. And that rice strain may take over the biggest loss of Bangladesh simply in order to withstand these long floods of global warming so that people can eat. And her husband runs the student organic farm on campus and is a leader in an organic farming movement. So they travel the world as an odd couple that attempt to break down these notions of purity or these religious notions that because science is dangerous, we therefore have to get out the pitchforks and torches and chase off the monster. What role for religion in a sustainable future? Good question, and a hard question. And I would say that it's good to remind people that we don't have the slightest ability to know what's going on in the universe. That before the Big Bang is mysterious, that the reasons why things are here is mysterious, the physical constants are mysterious. It's just as easy as can be to say it's a miracle, because it is a miracle. And so one can have an attitude towards the universe as being sacred. That all religions are trying to say, this existential situation that we find ourselves in is obviously miraculous. Something's going on. Maybe there's a God. Maybe we're an experiment. Maybe we're being viewed right now and recorded for all eternity. Maybe there is eternity. Maybe reality is just as a, you know, all these are so easily supported by when you look up at the night sky that you can, I say to do translations. You just simply translate the ordinary religious feelings that religious people have into a kind of environmentalism, a kind of humanism, or whatever. However you want to do these translations, they're equivalencies. But a feeling for the sacred is a very deep, deep feeling. In this, you know, this expanding brain that I talked about earlier, you can now tweak the part of the brain that will put people into a St. Teresa-like religious ecstasy. There is a part of the brain for religious ecstasy, and it's very close to hypergraphia and epilepsy and all kinds of dysfunctions. But presumably, it's the good part of this, you know, this part of the brain, because it does feel good. It feels like meaning, and meaningfulness is profoundly close to happiness. You want meaning real bad, and so there's a big part of our brain ready for it. Like the same way there's a big part of our brain ready for the sight of fire. You see a fire, you go, yeah, that's. Well, you get these religious feelings, you say, yeah, that's good. So that's how I do it in terms of these translations. Yes, let's do just one more here. This gentleman here, and then we have to just go to the bar and discuss it there. Not be purely. I would accept those as emergency stopgaps in the way, in the spirit they're being offered as emergency gestures towards a larger solution. And you just take one step at a time, just like you vote for, you know, you vote for social democracy as one step at a time towards revolution. So let's end with the word revolution and go have lunch. And thank you very much.